The Progress of Colored Women by Mary Church Terrell. In her autobiography, A Colored Woman in a White World, published in 1940, Mary Church Terrell wrote, "I was invited to speak to the Congregational Association of Maryland and the District of Columbia, which was holding a meeting in the First Congregational Church. Contrary to a custom observed all my life when speaking in public, I used a manuscript and spoke on the progress of colored women. This speech, the only one of many delivered by Mrs. Terrell that was preserved, was fortunately published in The Voice of the Negro in July 1904. Mary Church Terrell was born in Memphis at the end of the Civil War. Her mother had been educated in slavery, and her father, Robert R. Church, Sr., was the son of a pro-Union slave owner who made a fortune in real estate. Mary was sent to the North for schooling at 6. After being graduated from Oberlin College, she taught at Wilberforce University and at a colored high school in Washington, D.C. She married Robert J. Terrell, a black graduate of Harvard University, who became a municipal judge in Washington, a position he occupied for 20 years. Active in work among Negro women, Mrs. Terrell was elected the first president of the National Association of Colored Women. Mrs. Terrell was still actively fighting Jim Crow in Washington at the age of 89. In its issue of November 25, 1890, the Colored American of Washington, D.C., said of Mary Church Terrell, "As a platform orator and champion of the rights and privileges of the race, she has no superior among her sex in all the land."
When one considers the obstacles encountered by colored women in their effort to educate and cultivate themselves since they became free, the work they have accomplished and the progress they have made will bear favorable comparison, at least with that of their more fortunate sisters, from whom the opportunity of acquiring knowledge and the means of self-culture have never been entirely withheld. Not only are colored women with ambition and aspiration handicapped on account of their sex, but they are almost everywhere baffled and mocked because of their race. Not only because they are women, but because they are colored women, are discouragement and disappointment meeting them at every turn. But in spite of the obstacles encountered, the progress made by colored women along many lines appears like a veritable miracle of modern times. 40 years ago, for the great masses of colored women, there was no such thing as home. Today, in each and every section of the country, there are hundreds of homes among colored people, the mental and moral tone of which is as high and as pure as can be found among the best people of any land. To the women of the race may be attributed in large measure the refinement and purity of the colored home. The immorality of colored women is a theme upon which those who know little about them or those who maliciously misrepresent them love to descant. Foul aspersions among the character of colored women are assiduously circulated by the press of certain sections, and especially by the direct descendants of those who in years past were responsible for the moral degradation of their female slaves. And yet, in spite of the fateful heritage of slavery, even though the safeguards usually thrown around maidenly youth and innocence are in some sections entirely withheld from colored girls, statistics compiled by men not inclined to falsify in favor of my race show that immorality among the colored women of the United States is not so great as among women with similar environment and temptations in Italy, Germany, Sweden, and France. Scandals in the best colored society are exceedingly rare, while the progressive game of divorce and remarriage is practically unknown. The intellectual progress of colored women has been marvelous. So great has been their thirst for knowledge, and so Herculean their efforts to acquire it, that there are few colleges, universities, high and normal schools in the North, East, and West, from which colored girls have not graduated with honor. In Wellesley, Vassar, Ann Arbor, Cornell, and in Oberlin, my dear alma mater, whose name will always be loved and whose praise will always be sung as the first college in the country, broad, just, and generous enough to extend a cordial welcome to the Negro and to open its doors to women on an equal footing with the men, colored girls, by their splendid records, have forever settled the question of their capacity and worth. The instructors in these and other institutions cheerfully bear testimony to their intelligence, their diligence, and their success. As the brains of colored women expanded, their hearts began to grow. No sooner had the heads of a favored few been filled with knowledge than their hearts yearned to dispense blessings to the less fortunate of their race. With tireless energy and eager zeal, colored women have worked in every conceivable way to elevate their race. Of the colored teachers engaged in instructing our youth, it is probably no exaggeration to say that fully 80% are women. In the backwoods, remote from the civilization and comforts of the city and town, colored women may be found courageously battling with those evils which such conditions always entail. Many a heroine, of whom the world will never hear, has thus sacrificed her life to her race amid surroundings and in the face of privations which only martyrs can bear. Through the medium of their societies in the church, beneficial organizations out of it, and clubs of various kinds, colored women are doing a vast amount of good. It is almost impossible to ascertain exactly what the Negro is doing in any field, for the records are so poorly kept. This is particularly true in the case of the women of the race. During the past 40 years, there is no doubt that colored women in their poverty have contributed large sums of money to charitable and educational institutions, as well as to the foreign and home missionary work. Within the 25 years in which the educational work of the African Methodist Episcopal Church has been systematized, the women of that organization have contributed at least $500,000 to the cause of education. Dotted all over the country are charitable institutions for the aged, orphaned, and the poor, which have been established by colored women. Just how many it is difficult to state, owing to the lack of statistics bearing on the progress, possessions, and prowess of colored women. Among the charitable institutions either founded, conducted, or supported by colored women may be mentioned the Hale Infirmary of Montgomery, Alabama, the Carrie Steele Orphanage of Atlanta, the Reed Orphan Home of Covington, and the Haynes Industrial School of Augusta, all three in the state of Georgia. A home for the aged of both races in New Bedford and St. Monica's Home of Boston in Massachusetts, Old Folks Home of Memphis, Tennessee, and the Colored Orphans Home of Lexington, Kentucky, together with others which lack of space forbids me to mention. Mount Meigs Institute is an excellent example of a work originated and carried into successful execution by a colored woman. The school was established for the benefit of colored people on the plantations in the Black Belt of Alabama. In the township of Mount Meigs, the population is practically all colored. Instruction given in this school is of the kind best suited to the needs of the people for whom it was established. Along with some scholastic training, girls are taught everything pertaining to the management of the home, while boys are taught practical farming, wheel riding, blacksmithing, and have some military training. Having started with almost nothing, at the end of 8 years, the trustees of the school owned 9 acres of land and 5 buildings in which several thousand pupils had received instructions, all through the energy, the courage, and the sacrifice of one little woman. Up to date, politics have been religiously eschewed by colored women, although questions affecting our legal status as a race is sometimes agitated by the most progressive class. In Louisiana and Tennessee, colored women have several times petitioned the legislatures of their respective states to repeal the obnoxious Jim Crow car laws. Against the convict lease system, whose atrocities have been so frequently exposed of late, colored women here and there in the South are waging a ceaseless war. And so long as hundreds of their brothers and sisters, many of whom have committed no crime or demeanor whatever, are thrown into cells whose cubic contents are less than those of a good-sized grave, to be overworked, overfed, and only partially covered with vermin-infested rags. And so long as children are born to the women in these camps who breathe the polluted atmosphere of these dens of horror and vice, from the time they utter their first cry in the world till they are released from their suffering by death, colored women who are working for the emancipation and elevation of their race know where their duty lies. By constant agitation of this painful and hideous subject, they hope to touch the conscience of the country so that this stain shall be forever wiped away. Alarmed at the rapidity with which the Negro is losing ground in the world of trade, some of the far-sighted women are trying to solve the labor question, so far as it concerns the women at least, by urging the establishment of schools of domestic science wherever means therefore can be secured. Those who are interested in this particular work hope and believe that if colored women and girls are thoroughly trained in domestic service, the boycott which has undoubtedly been placed upon them in many sections of the country will be removed. With so few vocations open to the Negro, and with the labor organizations increasingly hostile to him, the future of the boys and girls of the race appears to some of our women very foreboding and dark. The cause of temperance has been eloquently espoused by two women, each of whom has been appointed national superintendent of work among colored people by the Women's Christian Temperance Union. In business, colored women have had signal success. There is in Alabama a large milling and cotton business belonging to and controlled by a colored woman who has sometimes as many as 75 men in her employ. Until a few years ago, the principal ice plant of Nova Scotia was owned and managed by a colored woman who sold it for a large amount. In the professions, there are dentists and doctors whose practice is lucrative and large. Ever since a book was published in 1773 entitled Poems on Various Subjects, Religious and Moral, by Phyllis Wheatley, Negro servant of Mr. John Wheatley of Boston, colored women have given abundant evidence of literary ability. In sculpture, we are represented by a woman upon whose chisel Italy has set her seal of approval. In painting, by one of Bouguereau's pupils, and in music, by young women holding diplomas from the best conservatories in the land. In short, to use a thought of the illustrious Frederick Douglass, if judged by the depths from which they have come, rather than by the heights to which those blessed with centuries of opportunities have attained, colored women need not hang their heads in shame. They are slowly but surely making their way up to the heights, wherever they can be scaled. In spite of handicaps and discouragements, they are not losing heart. In a variety of ways, they are rendering valiant service to their race. Lifting as they climb onward and upward, they go struggling and striving and hoping that the buds and blossoms of their desires may burst into glorious fruition ere long. Seeking no favors because of their color, nor charity because of their needs, they knock at the door of justice and ask for an equal chance.